and learn. So this will be the beast and the false prophet, the revived Roman Empire, the one world government, and the mark of the beast. And this plays an important part in the end time events. So let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for the meal that you have so graciously provided. And we thank you, Lord, for the four sessions that we have had up to now, and for your guidance, your protection, and your wisdom that you have given to us to study these difficult topics. And now as we go in to learn about the man of sin, we pray and ask you, Lord, that this not be just an intellectual exercise, but we will also learn from this and warn the people around us so that they will not have to get caught to his kingdom or his rule. Pray and ask that you will continue to be with us. For those who are traveling back, give them journeying mercies, and be with us, protect us, and guide us. In Jesus' name, amen. So this is generally a topic that creates a lot of interest, mainly out of curiosity. And we will look at these two bad men, the beast and the false prophet. And as I said yesterday during the introduction, that we will avoid the use of the term Antichrist or Antichrist for the beast, because that's not a term that the Bible uses. He's generally known as the man of sin, man of lawlessness, and the most common word for him is the beast, because he behaves like one. I got so much of material in this, but we can't do all that within 1 hour, 15 minutes. So let's try and take the important ones and all the relevant parts as well. Chapter 13 of Revelation deals with the two beasts. Both are referred to as beasts. The beast initially, and then the false prophet after that. And you noticed, and we also studied this yesterday, that the beast comes out of the sea, whereas the false prophet comes out of the earth. And we have already seen that the sea in the Bible is primarily, it symbolizes the restless nations of the world, Gentile nations of the world. So the beast will come up from one of the Gentile nations. And the land in the Bible symbolizes the land of Palestine or Israel or the Holy Land. So the false prophet will come out of the land of Israel. And these two men are more or less central characters in this whole Great Tribulation drama, or Daniel's 70th week. So we reach the stage, the rapture has taken place, and the time for the beast has come, and we will see how the beast comes into existence. We have already studied Daniel 7, 2-7, so we will not go too much into the details. And the last beast in Daniel 7, that is the unnamed beast. The description is not given to us except for the fact that it is ferocious and it has iron teeth that symbolize the Roman Empire. Also seems to symbolize this particular beast. And why are the beast and the false prophet referred to as beasts? Because they are very cruel and they can destroy, and that's the purpose. And here they bring in together political power and mix it with church or religious power. The beast will look after the political side of Satan's kingdom on earth. The false prophet will look after the religious side. And they combine them together. And in the world history, every time we combine political power with religious power, it has always ended up in disaster, more often than not. The best example might be a new religion that was created in the 7th century AD, also known as Islam today, was primarily a political movement coupled with a newly formed religion, and it has really caused havoc throughout the last 1,400 years of its existence. And this will be the same. The first beast, or what we refer to as the beast, will be the head of the revived Roman Empire. And that revived Roman Empire is going to be a kind of a global body or global political authority that's going to dominate the world, and it'll come out of some sort of chaos. If you look at the world events now, we are heading in a chaotic direction. at the end of the First World War, we called it the Great War, and we said, no more wars. And they said, this is the end of war. But within a couple of decades, we started the Second World War, and they said, no more. And we established initially the League of Nations after the First World War, the United Nations after the Second World War. But now, as things are working out, there is a possibility of a global war, because so many geopolitical interests are coming into what's happening in the world today. So any kind of war is now possible. And there is also a lot of proliferation of nuclear weapons now, and with Iraq and North Korea entering into the scene. And we laugh at the North Koreans, but very soon they will have ICBMs to reach the American mainland and also Russia on the other side. And there will be chaos, revolution, and anarchy. And it is in those situations that the original Rome arose, on the banks of the river Tiber. The city of Rome, just to go back in history, was built shortly before the 10 tribes of Israel were captured by the Assyrians in 726 or 720 BC, around that time. So at that time it was a small village or small city-state. But within 700 years it became perhaps the greatest superpower ever on the face of the earth. Going to John 13 and verse 1, John speaks to Revelation 13 and verse 1, John points to the future revival and reappearance of the revived Roman Empire after many centuries. We know that as a political power, the Western Roman Empire collapsed in the 6th century, or 5th century rather, and the Eastern Roman Empire collapsed in the 16th century, and they were defeated by the Ottomans. The last king of the Western Roman Empire in 476 AD, interestingly, was a very feeble ruler by the name of Romulus Augustus. There is a lot of irony in that the naming of that chap. Romulus, as you remember with Remus, was one of the founders of Rome, and Augustus was the official name of Octavian, the first emperor of Rome. So that he has got the founder's name and the first emperor's name, and that was the end of the imperial line. Now, why do these two men, the beast and the false prophet, come into the picture? Satan, as we know, is a spirit being. Satan has no form. So the picture of this funny-looking creature with horns and canines jutting out, and spiky ears, and a trident with hoofs, that is just a picture that emerged, interestingly, only about 600, 700 years ago. Satan doesn't look like that. Satan is an attractive angel. I don't think sin has marred his good looks. But Satan is a spirit being. So in order to carry out his plans here on earth, he needs human vessels. And the beast and the false prophet are not the first human vessels that he is using. Perhaps the very first he used was Cain. Eve wasn't a vessel, but in the sense he tempted her. But maybe Cain is the one who committed the first real sin in the Bible. And throughout centuries, now if you can take somebody like Hitler, he caused a lot of death and destruction through Hitler. So he works through people. So sometimes as Christians we are attacked or persecuted, we must never take it personally. It's from the devil himself. So during the tribulation period, he'll use the body and mind of two people, the beast and the false prophet. This I've already explained, that the beast comes from the sea symbolizing the Gentile, restless Gentile nations. For example, Isaiah 17:12, woe to the many nations that rage, they rage like the raging sea. Woe to the peoples who roar, they roar like the roaring of great waters. So that's an indication that the Bible looks at the sea as the nations of the world. And it's also interesting that the beast is seen coming out of the waters of the sea. He doesn't just jump out, but little by little, gradually, he comes up. So that also symbolizes the fact that you will not wake up one morning. We won't be there, but let's say the people of the world will not wake up one morning and say, this is the beast. No. So it's basically, he will be revealed little by little. First, the tip of the horns are seen, then the head comes out, then the body, and then the feet. So it will be revealed in a very slow manner. The beast is first mentioned in Revelation 11:7. For some people, the beast is the revived Roman Empire. Some others believe that the beast is a person, an evil person, a real human being. I think the evidence in the Bible points to him being a real human being, an individual, because the Bible uses a masculine term of that of a human being. It's referred to him as a he. So he's a human being, but he'll be in charge of the revived Roman Empire. So if you go back to what was said yesterday or early morning today, Nebuchadnezzar was the first great, when I say great, not great in the sense of good, but powerful world ruler during the times of the Gentiles. And the times of the Gentiles will end with the end of Daniel's 70th week, at the end of the tribulation. We'll remember that rock that comes and smashes the feet of clay and iron. And the feet of clay and iron is the revived Roman Empire. And that will be led by this man. When will the beast be revealed? When will we know the beast? Or when can we identify him? Throughout the ages, so many people have been named as the beast, and they are not. Many of the popes, for example, Napoleon, Charlemagne, the German emperor, many of the emperors of Rome, and notably Nero was a popular choice to be the man of sin or the Antichrist, Antiochus Epiphanes, Antiochus the Fourth, remember the guy who sacrificed the pig on the altar. Then more recently Stalin. Then we have heard names like Hitler, and I actually heard somebody in Colombo saying a few years ago that Tony Blair is the next, is the beast, and George W. Bush has been mentioned, and you can guess the time period, the Iraq War period, and recently we have heard about poor Donald Trump. So many names have been thrown, but this is what the Bible says. The Bible says
Donald Trump is not good looking.
That's not what the ladies think, okay, right. Neither were George W. Bush and Tony Blair. Hitler, he looked like Charlie Chaplin. 2 Thessalonians 2, 1 to 12. Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by some prophecy, report, or letter supposed to have come from us, saying that the day of the Lord has already come. Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed. That is rebellion connected to the beast. That is the end times, the Daniel 70th week. So, Lord will not come until the man of lawlessness is revealed. The man doomed to destruction. He will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God or is worshipped. So he'll lift himself up to be worshipped, so that he sets himself up in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God. And that is the abomination that causes desolation. At the end of the 3.5 years of tribulation, he will set himself up as God, and he'll set his image and tell everyone, look, I'm the Messiah, I'm the God, start worshipping me.
So he will reign from the temple?
No, temple is not a political place. He'll reign perhaps from either from Jerusalem or most likely from, many people think, from Rome. But Rome can be symbolic as well. See, he will not reign from Jerusalem. You know why? That's why he's putting his idol there, his image there. So most likely he's somewhere else. Rome can stand for a modern world capital. It can either be in North America or Europe or Asia or somewhere. So he might rule from there. And today, air travel and private jets and all that, you can get there very fast. But from a religious perspective, he's eyeing the holy city because it belongs to God. His battle is against God, so he will set up his image there. Don't you remember that when I was with you, I used to tell you these things. And now you know what is holding him back, so that he may be revealed at the proper time. For the secret power of lawlessness is already at work, not only in the 21st century, but 1st century AD. Let me just digress a little bit. There is what is known in the scriptures as the spirit of, the concept as the spirit of Amalek. Amalek was the grandson of Esau. Esau was the twin brother of Jacob. Remember, in the mother's womb itself, they were wrestling. And when they were born, Esau was first born, and he was supposed to take over the spiritual blessings that comes from being the firstborn. But he traded it away for a pot of stew, for rice and curry or whatever, generally lentil stew, most likely. Now, he, the word of God says, see, sometimes I used to feel sorry for him when I heard this story in Sunday school. You know what it is to be hungry, and this guy paid him out. But I think it's not just the fact that he gave it away for a pot of stew. The issue was that the Bible tells us that he hated the things of God. He despised, that's the word. And despise is a very strong word. He despised God, he despised spiritual things, and he despised anything to do with God. So he hated God, and his grandson is Amalek. The Amalekites in the Bible are descendants of Amalek. And when the Israelites were coming, their distant cousins were coming from Egypt, and they were on their way to the Holy Land, the Amalekites should have, as their relatives, long lost relatives, they should have embraced them and supported them, fed them and given them water. They refused to meet with them, and they then shamelessly attacked them from behind. And when you have 2 to 3 million people walking, generally the weak, the women, the aged, the children, they were the ones who would have been at the back. So they shamelessly and in a cowardly fashion attacked from behind. So God was angry with them. See, if they had blessed the Israelites, even today they might have existed as a nation. God said he will wipe the memory of Amalek from the face of the earth. Initially, King Saul was given that responsibility, and we read that King Saul did not carry it out properly. And one of the reasons why God rejected Saul as king. Later on, King Hezekiah knocked off or killed the last of the Amalekites, and their memory was completely wiped from the face of the earth. The lesson in that is that the spirit of Amalek, or the disobedient spirit, is there with us even today in this world. Sometimes you find the spirit of Amalek in the church itself. Sometimes even Christians can be guilty of that spirit of disobedience. And Paul says that spirit of lawlessness or power of lawlessness was already at work during his time, more so as we go towards the end time events. So one thing that's going to characterize the 7 years of tribulation and going to characterize the man of sin is that power of lawlessness. He will be a man of lawlessness. He will not obey God. He will totally disobey God. And now you know what is holding him back, so that he may be revealed at the proper time. He's saying, look, something is holding him back. For the secret power of lawlessness is already at work, but the one who now holds it back will continue to do so till he is taken out of the way. So, who is he talking about? God the Holy Spirit. He is holding back the spirit of lawlessness. So, if you think that the world is bad, you can imagine bad as it is now with the spirit of God holding it back. Just imagine the tribulation period when the spirit of God is taken away. And it will be a time of huge lawlessness, a time of terrible lawlessness, and the world will be literally hell. More of the judgments and seals and trumpet judgments and all tomorrow morning. Now, and then, see, but the one who now holds it back will continue to do so till he is taken out of the way. Then means after he is taken out of the way, that is the rapture, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will overthrow with the breath of his mouth and destroy by the splendor of his coming. Amen. He comes riding on the white horse,
yes,
with the saints, that is us, and the heavenly host following him. A sword comes out of his mouth and he will destroy this man. And we saw that at the end of the battle of Armageddon, the beast and the false prophet will be caught alive and thrown into the lake of fire. The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles. So Satan loves to copy the Lord. The Lord performs miracles, Satan performs counterfeit miracles. All kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs and wonders, and every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie, and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth but have delighted in wickedness. Before you raise the question, let me digress a little bit and explain this. In the Bible, we see that God sometimes sends a delusion over people. If people are refusing to believe the truth, God will step aside and allow them to find the lie. And you see that happening many times. You see that in the case of King Ahab. You see that in the case of Pharaoh in Egypt. And you see that in the case of many others. If they refuse to believe the truth, God will not contend with them all the time. He'll step aside and he'll allow them to believe a lie. Romans chapter 1 tells us, but because people have become so degraded and they have become so evil in their faith, that God allowed them to believe a lie. And that's there. So as much as possible, the Spirit of God will contend with humanity, with you and me. But we insist on believing a lie. He'll step aside and allow us to believe a lie. A good example comes from the last elections, presidential elections we had in Sri Lanka. You know, there was a time I thought that we will never, in my lifetime, I will never see the end of Rajapaksa or his family member. And he was so well entrenched. But I also kept understanding from God's scripture that I felt the Spirit of God telling me, and I openly said it, God has his own way of dealing with tyrants and in his own time. What happened? God made him believe a lie. He went to the astrologer and he had two more years to go. In fact, this was the year when he should have stood in for the third election. So he went to the astrologer and he said, now is the time. January 2015, if you go, it's favorable. The Saturn is in the seventh house and Jupiter is in somebody else's house. You know, if you go now, it'll work. And he went straight into it and lost. That, I believe, was allowed by God. God allowed him to believe a lie so that he can move away from his evil ways. So he did that. So it is biblical, but God will only do it as a last resort. He will do his best. And I know so many people have given the gospel plain and clear to this man, but he is unwilling, and he was a real idol worshipper. You have seen those stuff on his hands, the peritoneal, like a bracelet. And then he had this charm, that Korean charm. It's a weird looking thing. I've seen it. I met him once and he had that thing. He was playing around with that in his hand and it went everywhere he went. It looked a hideous, demonic thing. So his power came from the dark side and God had to defeat him. Right. Now, some things about the beast. He had 10 horns and 7 heads with 10 crowns on his horns. So, 7 heads, 10 horns, so some heads had extra horns, and each horn had a crown. And here, the heads speak of wisdom. Does it mean that he was very wise? Not from a spiritual perspective. He was wise in the sense that he has a brilliant mind. Secondly, horns speak of confederated power or groupings of nations will come under him. And crowns represent, this is diadema, this crown, not Stephanos. These represent ruling authority. So here is a man with huge amount of power, ruling over many groups of nations. So he's a global leader. And he has enough intelligence. He's not a stupid guy. And he's not a stupid politician. He has enough intelligence to know how to manage the things of this world, but sadly he's up against the Lord himself. Now, Daniel predicted. Now, remember, he had 10 crowns. Number 10 is important. Daniel predicted that the revived Roman Empire or the Roman Empire will be revived in a 10-kingdom format. Now, this 10 has often confused people, but strict study of God's word and the culture, Middle Eastern culture, teaches us that 10 to the Gentiles is what 7 is to God. What does the number 7 stand for? Completion, perfection. In the Babylonian culture, in the Mediterranean culture, 10 stands for perfection and completion. That's why some believe that Daniel's fast for 10 days was not 10 literal days, but it was to show that it's a complete fast. Right. So there is a possibility that these 10 kingdoms are not 10 countries, but maybe 10 groupings, like you have a NATO alliance or the EU or ASEAN to SAARC to, you have so many groupings. All these groupings will pay homage to him and say, "You rule over us." So I think for me, it portrays a global empire. All the nations of the world will bow down before him. Daniel 7:24, the 10 horns are 10 kings who will come from this kingdom. After them, another king will arise, different from the earlier ones, and he will subdue 3 kings. He saw a vision of this. You have these 10 horns. Suddenly one horn comes up and displaces 3, knocks off 3. And that horn suddenly grows to become a big horn. So the symbolism there is that there may be 10 groupings of nations, all powerful. Then out of that, there will be one nation coming up, and the leader of that nation will be this man. He will come and knock down 3 of those nations or groupings, and suddenly he'll become one of the big guys. And thereafter, he'll take over all the kingdoms. So that shows that the beast will not become a ruler overnight, but he will work his way up after the rapture. After the one who holds it back has been taken away, he will work his way up, and little by little, he'll knock down some of the kingdoms. Perhaps he will invade some of the other countries, and he will accumulate power. And one day he becomes so powerful that all the other leaders also bow down before him. Now, how is he able to do it? How is he able to suddenly become so powerful from a very humble beginning? Because he's energized by Satan. So it's satanic power. And remember what Satan told the Lord during his temptation? These kingdoms are mine. You bow down before me, fall down and worship me, I'll give it to you. That's where the Lord Jesus refused to do, this man will do it. So effectively, he's a Satan worshipper, and he will sell his soul to the devil for this temporary earthly power. He also had 7 heads, and this possibly could be 7 kings or 7 types of rulers who will emerge in that empire and who will bow down to him. The 10 crowns, as I've said, is diadema. I've explained it. And it's the word diadema is used of the dragon in chapter 12, that is the devil, beast chapter 13, and Christ chapter 19. So his power comes from the devil. And what is interesting here is that on each of these 7 heads, there is a blasphemous name. Means his entire kingdom will be built on blaspheming the God of heaven. So he'll have something, maybe the slogan, the vision, mission of his kingdoms, and his every country that's under him, their job will be to blaspheme God. Even today the world is blaspheming God like anything. Even within the Christian church, there's so much of blasphemy against the true God of heaven. So during that period, tribulation period, blasphemy will be the new normal. And he will claim to be God. And you can imagine, even now in countries like North Korea, they don't have an official religion. But the religion, if you ask me what their religion is, it is Kimism. You know, they worship the Kims. And, they are treated like a demigod. And so even in some of the other dictatorial setups, that was the same. They built up a cult following, and this man will do the same thing. So he'll claim to be God. For example, I mentioned Domitian. He was known as Dominus et Deus Noster, means our Lord and God. So like the early Roman emperors, this man will also want to be worshipped. And this one I'm going to skip because we saw it last time or in the morning session, where he will be like the beast who will combine the characteristics of the lion, the leopard, and the bear. And that's the image. I'm going to skip that. And he's also the feet of iron and feet of clay. That's his empire. So this we have dealt with. Sorry, it's a repetition. So just to give you an idea, he will be leading this kingdom, feet of iron and mixed with clay. And this crushing rock is the Lord Jesus. Some of these we have already seen, and that's why I wanted to do it today, because we studied all this today. And another picture of this, and right at the back looking like a dragon or a dinosaur, is the other beast, which is an indescribable beast, which is a terrible one. And this, I think, is the best picture because you can see blood on those rib bones of Medo-Persia, Babylon. And then here you have Greece, and that is the Roman Empire. And the beast will be hideous. Not physically, he will not look ugly like that. He'll be perhaps a good-looking man, but that's the idea. Okay. So the revived Roman Empire will be swift, like Alexander the Great, a leopard. He'll be powerful, the tenacity of purpose, I've said, as a bear. And it'll be greedy, the appetite for conquest, as a lion. So this beast will be even more powerful than those ancient Roman empires about which we have found so many prophecies right now. So he'll be the last of the world rulers. One of the interesting things that I want to leave with you is this, a comparison between the beast and the Lord. First of all, the beast has a body like that of a leopard. Now, a leopard, as we know, is covered with spots. And Jeremiah 13:23, can the Ethiopian change his skin or the leopard its spots? Neither can you do good who are accustomed to doing evil. Effectively, the leopard spots are used by Jeremiah to show the ingrained character of Judah's sin. In other words, leopard spot there may symbolize the sin that is in this man of evil. But at the same time, our Lord Jesus is not referred to as a leopard. He is referred to as the Lamb of God, a lamb without spot or blemish. See the comparison. The beast is like a leopard, bloodthirsty, ready to kill, and full of sin. The Lord Jesus is gracious, merciful, loving, and spotless. Secondly, his feet were like those of a bear. And as you know, a bear walks in a very ungainly fashion. As I said, if somebody tells you, your walk is so wonderful, you walk like a bear, you might as well attack them because they are ugly. But and a bear always leaves a trail of blood behind. But the Lord Jesus, when he walked by, his walk was so beautiful that John the Baptist looked at him and said, "Behold," or "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." His walk through this world was so clean and beautiful. Thirdly, lion. He was like a lion. His mouth. In other words, the mouth of a lion is raging and harmful. And if you didn't know this, apparently lions have a lot of harmful bacteria on their teeth. You don't see lions brushing their teeth. And when a lion bites its prey, sometimes the prey might escape, but the prey will die within a short time because of the infection that will come from those teeth. So it is all about death and tearing apart. Because out of the mouth of this beast will come blasphemies. What about the Lord Jesus? He is referred to in a symbolic sense in the Song of Solomon 5:16. His mouth is sweetness itself. He is altogether lovely. In fact, when he spoke, Such was the graciousness of these words that people said, no man has ever spoken like this. So you see the comparison between the beast and the Lord, there is actually no comparison. Now the beast has the following names in the Bible. Firstly, and you notice, Antichrist is not one of them. That's why I'm purposely avoiding the use of that term to describe the beast. In Revelation, the beast. Daniel, the horn or world power. Daniel 9, the desolator. Matthew 24:15, the abomination that causes desolation. Daniel 8:23-25, the king of fierce countenance. So none of these are very pleasant. Now what are the attributes of the beast? What will he be like? From the scriptures, we have an idea as to what he'll look like. And I won't read those verses, but the references are given there. Daniel 8:23, we will notice, Daniel gives a full description of the beast. He'll be an intellectual genius. In order to build up a world empire like that, you need brains, and he'll be a very intellectual man, whose brains will work very fast. He is also, in Daniel 11:36, oratorical genius. He can speak very well. Now, Hitler, in spite of the fact that he was short and he had a very funny Charlie Chaplin mustache, when he got on stage, he was a very powerful speaker. You may check it out on YouTube. He was able to drive the crowd into a frenzy with his speech. This man is able to do that. Almost all good politicians have that skill. Then Revelation 17, he's a political genius. You know, he's able to play politics very well in order to survive all the issues and come to the top. And Daniel 11:43, Revelation 13, we notice that he's a commercial genius. He's able to run the economy of the world. Revelation 6:2 and 13:2, he's a military genius. 2 Thessalonians 2:4, Revelation 13:8, he's a religious genius. He's able to create a new religion where he will bring in all the religions together and make it one global religion of which he is the head. He is the God. Revelation 13:1 indicates that he might be a Gentile. He's coming from the Gentile nations, but let me qualify by saying that he might come from the Gentile nations, he might have a bit of Jewish blood in him. Otherwise, the Jews will not accept him as the Messiah. Finally, Daniel 7:8, he will emerge from the revived Roman Empire. Now, where does he get his power? This is something that I explained yesterday, but I want you to remember this. The dragon gave the beast his dunamis. The power here is dunamis. This dunamis in the Bible is unhindered power. Means power to do anything. High level of power. Let me explain that. Before the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, before Easter, Satan had this dunamis power or unrestricted power. Luke 10:19, I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the dunamis of the enemy, all the unrestricted power of the enemy, nothing will harm you. But after the resurrection, whenever the Bible spoke about power, it uses the word exousia, which is a kind of limited power. Dunamis power is a high level of power. Exousia is a lower level of power. During the church age, so to put it very simply, up to the resurrection, Satan had dunamis power, high level of power. From the resurrection to the rapture, virtually the church age, he has only limited power, exousia power. Then, after the rapture, in that verse that we read earlier, Satan gives him dunamis power again. In other words, who has dunamis power, unrestricted power, during the church age? Us, the body of Christ. And why is this power given to us? To win the World Cup? No. This power is given to us to witness and to win souls. That's the reason it's given to us. So today, we are more powerful than Satan. Remember the Great Commission in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8? But you will receive unrestricted power, dunamis power, when the Holy Spirit comes on you. Don't underestimate the power of God, the Holy Spirit. Sadly, sometimes the work of the Holy Spirit today is sometimes taken to extremes and misinterpreted. But remember, the primary purpose the Spirit of God is given to us is for power, dunamis power, so that we will live and carry out the Great Commission in our lives, that we will serve God, serve His body, serve humanity, and to win people to Christ and to baptize them and to disciple them. That's why the dunamis power is given to us. So each and every one of us as believers, we have that power. And then He says, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So remember the missionaries we talked about, when they went to the ends of the earth, they went with that dunamis power. When you came to this camp, you came with that dunamis power, and you're going back with that dunamis power. Satan is a defeated enemy, and you can trample his head. God has given you that power. And that power resides in us because God the Holy Spirit is in us. Amen. Romans 1:16, a famous verse. I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it is the dunamis power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew and for the Gentile. So at this time, Satan has limited power, exousia, which is a power subject to another power. So lower level. And he doesn't have real power. He has to act only with permission. Remember what I told you yesterday? He is on a leash. So he doesn't have unlimited power. So Ephesians 2:2, it's talking about the devil in the present age, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of kingdom, of the kingdom or exousia power of the air. So he has limited power. So I think I've made my point. Again in Colossians 1:13, for God, the Lord Jesus, has rescued us from the exousia, limited power of darkness, that is Satan, and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves. But so remember, after the Spirit of God is taken away, after the body of Christ, which now has dunamis power, is taken away, that dunamis power will be given to him. So during the 7-year period, Satan will do all kinds of counterfeit miracles and all kinds of things, and he will give that dunamis power, he will share it with his superman, the beast. Just a couple of things about the beast before we go to the false prophet. Revelation 13:3. The beast has a fatal wound. Fatal means he dies. But the whole world gets astonished because Satan is healed and he comes back to life. Now remember, Satan copies everything that God does. We have the godly Trinity, one God in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We have the satanic Trinity, Satan, the beast, and the false prophet. The Lord Jesus, the second person of the godly Trinity, died and came back to life. So here, the second person of the unholy Trinity will die and come back to life. Some people believe that this is, if the beast is the revived Roman Empire, the empire will lose the war and come back. But I think here the words that are used in the original Greek speak about one individual in the singular. So, the beast, maybe someone shoots him in the head, an assassination attempt. He will die and he'll rise from the dead. And for those who ever doubted whether he was the real Messiah, this is it. They will think, this is the guy. Remember, Jesus, he rose again from the dead. So this guy must be Christ. This guy is the Messiah. So he will astonish everyone. Now, that raises another question. Can Satan raise people from the dead? He can't. But I think God permits it in this way. It's part of the delusion. God doesn't raise him up from the dead. He allows Satan because this is the delusion that's going to delude all those people into believing in him. Now, if you look at this picture, this is the ancient Roman Empire. Covers a huge portion of North Africa, the Holy Land, Asia Minor, Europe, Western, almost entirety of Western Europe, all the way up to the Picts, that is just up to Scotland. And as I said, only that small village holds out against the might of Rome, Asterix and Obelix. Okay, if you haven't read that, don't worry. Okay. Now, this is not the revived Roman Empire, because EU is not the revived Roman Empire. It's only a small part of Western Europe and part of Eastern Europe. It doesn't come under any of these. So, just for you to get an idea. So, what is the revived Roman Empire today? Let me just explain to you and tell you what I feel about the revived Roman Empire. We are looking at a single world legal political system. And he's going to rule as the only world ruler. He will not tolerate any competition. He's going to be the only ruler. Now, the ancient Roman Empire, if you noticed, covered all these Western nations, including Britain, France, Spain, Portugal, Germany, Belgium, Italy. And Holland. If you notice, these are the Western nations that actually went and colonized the rest of the world. Almost the whole world, except parts of China, parts of Japan, Korea, Nepal, though they had a treaty with the British, and Bhutan. And Thailand is an interesting case in point. Thailand was ripe for capture, for colonization, but the British and the French met and they said, look, the French were in Indochina, in the Northeast, the British were in Southeast Asia, and they said, let's keep a buffer zone. And that's why Thailand was never colonized. French were on that side, British were on this side, everyone was happy. So except for a few nations, almost the entirety of Africa, except for the nations I mentioned in Asia, including the Pacific Islands, almost all of them were colonized by these Western European countries. And they belonged to the ancient Roman Empire. And by colonizing, you know what they did? They took the culture of the Roman Empire, the laws of the Roman Empire, and everything about the Roman Empire, even the political systems of the Roman Empire, and they spread it all over the world. I mean, we all come from Sri Lanka, if you, or at least, except maybe one or two. And if you look at Sri Lanka, if you look at the constitutional law, administrative law, our personal laws, commercial law, all of these originated in the ancient Roman Empire. So, what I'm putting across to you is this, that the revived Roman Empire is not EU, it is actually a global empire. It's the global culture that has come to be formed, and even today, nations like Thailand and Japan and China, which were never colonized, taking on the culture of the ancient Roman Empire. So, the revived Roman Empire that will be headed by the beast is primarily one global culture, the entire globe. Today we are in the process of globalizing everything. Came from the banking sector, we are in Bâle in Switzerland, they sit and do all the standardization. And whether you're working in Australia or Sri Lanka or United States or France, you follow similar rules when it comes to banking. And this is the standardization, globalization that we are coming to. Culturally, there is the Roman culture that has spread all over the world. And the religious systems that we have in many of the countries are kind of Romanized. So the world is ripe for this one world government to be led by the beast. So remember, it's not EU, because especially with Britain going, it makes it worse. EU is not a powerful body, and it never will be. And EU is too limited or restricted to be the revived Roman Empire. It's a global thing. So that's how I feel about the whole thing. A few things about the beast, the authority of the beast. The beast was given a mouth to utter proud words and blasphemies and to exercise his authority for 42 months.